والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين أما بعد السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Today, inshallah ta'ala, we begin the tafsir of Surah At-Tariq. Now, this Surah is a Surah which is Makkiyah by the consensus of the ulama, which means this Surah was reviewed before the Hijrah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to Al-Madinah. And from the names of this Surah is Surah At-Tariq and Surah Was-Sama'i Wat-Tariq. As for the theme of this Surah, then it speaks about the ability of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and how He encompasses all of the creation and how He is able to do whatever He wills with them subhanahu wa ta'ala, from bringing them to life and taking their souls and then bringing them back again. It also makes the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam firm in knowing that the victory of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will come and that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala helps the believers. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He begins this surah by swearing by the skies, as He does many times in this kitab, to show us the greatness of this creation that we have above us. He says, subhanahu wa ta'ala, was-sama'i wat-tariq, and by the sky. And as-sama' could actually mean the skies which are above us. And as-sama' could also mean that which is on top. So anything above us is called as-sama'. And from the things which are above are the skies, which is also called as-sama'. So Allah Jalla wa Ala here could be making an oath by the actual skies, or He could be making an oath by everything which is above the creation, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So He says, was-sama'i wat-tariq, by the skies and by at-tariq. And then He says, subhanahu wa ta'ala, wama adraka mat-tariq, and what will make you know what at-tariq is. So Allah Jalla wa Ala mentions at-tariq. So a person may think, what is this at-tariq? Then to draw the attention of those who are listening to the kitab of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah Jalla wa Ala says, وَمَا أَدْرَاكَ مَالطَّارِقِ, and what will make you know what this at-tariq is. Then He explains it subhanahu wa ta'ala, and He says, النَّجْمُ الثَّاقِبِ, it is the piercing star. النَّجْمُ الثَّاقِبِ, the piercing star. So Allah Jalla wa Ala makes an oath by the sky, and then He makes an oath by the piercing star. What is meant by the piercing star? The piercing star could actually mean the stars that we see in the sky at night, because their light pierces through the darkness of the skies. So this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala calls it the piercing stars. And another meaning mentioned by the ulama and the scholars of tafsir for al-najm al-thaqib are the stars which pierce through the shayateen, because the malaika, they throw the stars at the shayateen. So when we find a shooting star in the sky, it is actually an angel throwing this star at the shayateen. And we find from the kitab of Allah Jalla wa Ala and the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that the stars, they have three main purposes. The first purpose of the stars is to guide the creation. So when they are lost in their travels, they can look at the stars and they will know which direction to go, because there are certain stars which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has fixed in the skies and they do not move. And there are other stars, depending on the time of the month, where they will be in the skies. So those who have studied the stars will know how to travel. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says in the Qur'an, وَبِالنَّجْمِ هُمْ يَهْتَدُونَ, and through the stars they are guided. They are guided to their destination. So this is the first purpose of the stars. The second purpose of the stars, as mentioned in the kitab of Allah Jalla wa Ala, is to adorn the skies with them. As He says, subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَلَقَدْ زَيَّنَّا السَّمَاءَ الدُّنْيَا بِمَصَابِيحِ, that indeed we have adorned the sky of this world with stars. So when you look at the sky on a dark night, you will find that the stars are adorning the sky. And this is the beauty that Allah Jalla wa Ala has placed in the creation, for the creation to reflect over. Because whenever we find beauty in the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we know the one who has created this beauty is even more beautiful, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the third benefit of the stars, as mentioned in the kitab of Allah Jalla wa Ala, He said, وَجَعَلْنَاهَا رُجُومًا لِلشَّيَاطِينَ, that we have made them as things to pelter the shayateen with. And we find in the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, especially when the revelation was coming down to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the shayateen will go up to try and listen to the revelation. They'll try and steal something from the revelation so then they can tell the fortune tellers. about the revelation, so then they can try and deceive the people through the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which has been distorted by the shayateen. So the malaika were standing guard, and they would have the stars with them, and whenever a shaitan would come close to the revelation, they would throw the star at the shaitan. And this is why the shooting stars became very common at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because they were used to fire the shayateen with. So this is what Allah jalla wa ala means. An-najm al-thaqib, the piercing star, the stars that pierce through the shayateen, and the stars that pierce through the darkness of the skies, so the people can be guided through them, and so they can adorn the skies of this world. Then Allah jalla wa ala, he says, in kullu nafsin lamma alayha hafiz. That indeed, for every soul that Allah Jalla wa Ala has created, there are things that are guarding it. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes an oath by the skies. And then He makes an oath by the piercing stars, which guard the revelation given by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to mankind. And then He mentions, in kullu nafsin lamma alayha hafiz. That indeed, every single person, there is someone, something guarding it. So just like Allah Jalla wa Ala guarded the Quran, and just like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guards the skies, Allah Jalla wa Ala also guards every individual, to show you how great He is subhanahu wa ta'ala, and how many warriors He has subhanahu wa ta'ala, and how many angels He has Jalla wa Ala. So He says, in kullu nafsin lamma alayha hafiz. That indeed, for every soul that Allah Jalla wa Ala has created, there is something that is guarding it. And we find in the kitab of Allah Jalla وعلا, as we have taken in one of the previous chapters, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, wa inna alaykum lahafidhin. That indeed, that they are guarding you, kiraman katibin, those who are honorable, those who are writing down, ya'lamuna ma taf'alun, they know exactly that which you are doing. So every human being, Allah jalla wa ala has sent it angels that will guard it, angels that will guard all of the actions that they will perform, angels that will guard all of the statements that they have made, angels that will guard some of the beliefs that they have, angels also to guard the believers from the disbelievers, to protect them and to protect their iman. Allah Jalla wa Ala has sent angels to guard the creation. He says, in kullu nafsin lamma alayha hafiz. When we know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala now has sent angels to guard us, and that everything is being recorded, we now as human beings, as believers, have to try and guard and protect ourselves from doing anything that displeases Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the ulama, when they spoke about us guarding our actions and preserving ourselves from the temptations and the fitna of this world, they mentioned some of the tools and some of the ways that will assist us in doing this. And from the greatest way is to learn about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They said, if we learn about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we learn about His punishment, we learn about His adab, we learn about His ability, we learn about how He has the most perfect attributes. He can hear everything, and He can see everything, and He knows everything, and He knows the fine details of everything, and He is following everyone, and He is watching everyone, subhanahu wa ta'ala. The more we learn about Allah jalla wa ala, the more we will guard our actions. So one of the ways for us to preserve our actions and guard our actions and guard our iman is to learn about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Another way that the ulama have mentioned for us to learn how to guard our actions and be more conscious of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is to look at our limbs and know that on Yawm al-Qiyamah, for the disbelievers and those who will receive their kitab in their left hand and those who have disobeyed Allah jalla wa ala a great extent, that their limbs will begin to speak. So every time you are about to use that particular limb for haram, remember this limb is going to testify on Yawm al-Qiyamah. If you are going to use your hand for something haram, know that your hand is going to speak in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you're going to walk to something haram, know that your legs are going to speak in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Your body will speak in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Your skin will speak in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So for a person to learn how to guard himself, he needs to look at these blessings that Allah jalla wa ala has given him. And every time he's about to use them for haram, he should try and record the hereafter and how these actual limbs will begin to speak in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Another way for us to guard and preserve our actions is to know that the earth that we walk on, the earth that we walk on will be a test, we will testify either for us or against us on Yawm al-Qiyamah. The very earth that we stand on, the very earth that we may perform salah on, the very earth that we may sin and disobey Allah jalla wa ala on, it will stand on Yawm al-Qiyamah and it will speak and it will tell Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala everything that we have done, from the good of it and the bad of it. And this is why we have to be very careful. And that's why sometimes we forget that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is looking at us and He's watching us. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that the earth that you are standing on will testify. The limbs that you are using to disobey Allah jalla wa ala will testify. And greater than all of this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will testify. Because He knows everything subhanahu wa ta'ala. The angels on your right side and the angel on your left side, they will also testify. The kitab that will be bought, it will testify. It will have everything in there. Even the Quran that we recite will testify. As the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, وَالْقُرْآنُ حُجَّةٌ لَكَ أَوْ عَلَيْكَ. The Quran is either a proof for you or against you. So this is another way for us to try and rectify ourselves. That wherever we are on this earth, we're going to be somewhere. So wherever we are, this place will testify in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And however we sin, we have to sin with something. This thing that we have from our limbs, it will testify in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the thing that we use to sin will testify. And the place that we use, or the place that we are in to sin, it will also testify. So we cannot escape from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the reckoning in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And also another way for us is to continuously do good deeds. Because when we try and continuously do good deeds, it will push us away from haram. And it will make a barrier around us from committing sins. And that's why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he spoke to the young people, when he spoke to the shabab, the youth, he told them to fast. Why did he tell them to fast? He said, because fasting is a shield. Fasting becomes a shield around them. It protects them from that which is haram. So good deeds make a shield around the believer. And it protects him from haram. So Allah Jalla wa Ala, He says, وَالسَّمَاءِ وَالطَّارِقِ. And by the sky and At-Tariq. وَمَا أَدْرَاكَ مَا At-Tariq. And what will make you know what At-Tariq is? النَّجْمُ الثَّاقِبِ. It is the piercing star. إِن كُلُّ نَفْسٍ لَمَّا عَلَيْهَا حَافِظٍ. That indeed every soul and every person that Allah Jalla wa Ala has given it something to guard it. فَلْيَنْظُرِ الْإِنسَانُ مِمَّا خُلِقٍ. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, let man now look at how he was created. Allah Jalla wa Ala wants us to look at ourselves. He wants us to look at ourselves and reflect over ourselves and how we were created. So He says, فَلْيَنْظُرِ الْإِنسَانُ مِمَّ خُلِقٍ. Let man look at himself. What was he created from? خُلِقَ مِمَّا إِنْ دَافِقٍ. He was created from gushing fluids. He was created from gushing fluids. This is our beginning. It was gushing fluids. This is what we were created from. Then he says, subhanahu wa ta'ala, يَخْرُجُ مِنْ بَيْنِ الصُّلْبِ وَالتَّرَائِبِ. This gushing fluid, it came out from between the sulb and the tara'ib, from the backbone and the ribs. This gushing fluid now, it came from the back, between the backbone and the ribs. Now someone might question this and say, from what we know, this gushing fluid does not come from between the backbone and the ribs. Rather, this gushing fluid comes from a different place. A place that we all know and a place that we can witness. So what does Allah Jalla wa Ala mean by this? Modern science has discovered that the original place where this gushing fluid, the fluid of a man and also the fluid of a woman, the original place that it is formed is between the ribs and the backbone. And then as Allah Jalla wa Ala, He allowed the embryo to grow and the fetus to grow and it became a human being, it transferred from this area to the private parts. So this is a miracle of the Qur'an. A miracle of the Qur'an that maybe some of the scholars of the past didn't know about. But a miracle that has been discovered. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَخْرُجُ مِنْ بَيْنِ الصُّلْبِ وَالتَّرَائِبِ, this shows you, this is where it originates from. And when Allah Jalla wa Ala then formed the human being, then Allah Jalla wa Ala moved it from one place to another. But the original place where these fluids were formed was بَيْنَ الصُّلْبِ وَالتَّرَائِبِ, between the ribs and the backbone. So here this shows you how the kitab of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is complete and it is perfect. And whether modern science agrees with it or it disagrees with it, we know that the truth is always in the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And one thing that a believer must know, we never use science to prove the Qur'an. But we use the Qur'an to prove science. So if we find something in science that differs with the Qur'an, we say that either now science is incorrect, or we have incorrectly interpreted the Qur'an. But the Qur'an is never incorrect. Either science is incorrect, or we have misunderstood the Qur'an. Like some of the scholars, when they looked at the verses where Allah Jalla wa Ala said, He made the earth vast for us. They misunderstood from this that the earth was flat. But what does Allah Jalla wa Ala mean? He means that the earth that we walk on, not the earth in its entirety. So they misunderstood this. So then when science discovers this, are we going to say the Qur'an is wrong? We say no. This was their interpretation which was incorrect. But many scholars before them mentioned that the earth was round. From them was Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, who died about 700 years ago. He said the scholars have unanimously agreed And he said that the people of intellect have unanimously agreed that the earth is round. So now science, we do not say science is something that proves the Quran. The Quran proves science. So if we find something in the Quran and then science agrees with it, we say now we can say that science is correct because it has agreed with the Quran. But if we find something in the Quran which is clear and it cannot be misinterpreted, and science says something else, then we say we can guarantee you that science is incorrect. And a clear example of this is the theory of evolution. No matter how much they claim and how many evidences they claim that they have, this opposes the kitab of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on how he created Adam alayhi salam. Allah Jalla wa Ala created him from the earth. Allah Jalla wa Ala then created his wife from the rib of Adam alayhi salam. So if they say that Adam alayhi salam originated from another being, we say that this is incorrect because it conflicts with the Quran. Until they come and say science proved that Adam alayhi salam was created from earth, or science proved that man come from earth, then we will say that science is now correct. Other than this, we say science is incorrect because it conflicts with the kitab of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is a very important principle in the Sharia of Allah Jalla wa Ala. That if science coincides with the Quran or with the Sunnah or with the Sharia of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we do not say now, we do not become happy and say now look, we can see that the Quran is correct. No, the Quran was always correct. And the Sunnah was always correct. But what we can say is now science is correct. And what we can also say is that we have an evidence and another evidence now to show the people that the Quran is perfect and it is correct. But we do not prove the Quran. They prove the Quran through science. We prove science through the kitab of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah Jalla wa Ala says, يَخْرُجُ مِنْ بَيْنِ الصُّلْبِ وَالتَّرَائِبِ, that this ma'un dafiq, this gushing fluid, it came from between the ribs and the backbone. Then he says subhanahu wa ta'ala, إِنَّهُ عَلَىٰ رَجْعِهِ لَقَادِرٌ. So indeed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is able to bring mankind back. Allah Jalla wa Ala is able to bring the humans back. He now has showed you. He's saying to you, look and contemplate over yourself. What were you? You were nothing. You came from gushing fluids that originated from between the ribs and the backbone. This is what you came with. This is what you came from. If you came from this now, and then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made you into a human being, after you die and become nothing and you become dust, do you think Allah Jalla wa Ala cannot bring you back again? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses a rational argument to prove the resurrection, to prove Yawm al-Qiyamah. So he says subhanahu wa ta'ala, إِنَّهُ عَلَىٰ رَجْعِهِ لَقَادِرٌ. That indeed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is able to bring you back. If he was able to bring you the first time, and he was able to create you the first time, then he is able to bring you back again, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then he says, جَلَّ وَعَلَىٰ يَوْمَ تُبْلَ السَّرَائِرِ. The day when the secrets will be tested. The day when the secrets will be tested. What does it mean, the day when the secrets will be tested? In this dunya, in this world, we can only judge by that which is apparent. If we see a person pray, we say he takes the hukum of a Muslim. If we see a person committing disbelief clearly with his limbs, we say this person is a disbeliever. We can only judge by that which is apparent. And that's Umar radiallahu anhu in his famous speech, which has been collected by Bukhari and Muslim, he said that we do not know what is inside your chest, inside your bodies. We cannot cut any of you open to see what is inside you. So we will only judge you based on that which we can see and that which is apparent. So this is the life of this world. That humans can only judge one another by that which is apparent. And anyone can hide anything in their hearts. But as for the Qiyamah, as for the standing in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as for the resurrection, then Allah Jalla wa Ala says, يَوْمَ تُبْلَ السَّرَائِرِ, that the day when the secrets will be tested. That which your heart believed, that which your heart was firm upon, that which your heart maybe had doubts about, that which your heart was hiding, all of these things will now be exposed, and this will be the test. And this is the real test. So when we know that the real test in the Akhirah will be with regards to the heart, this tells us how much importance we have to give to our hearts. And that's why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Ala wa inna fil jasadi mudgha," that indeed in the bodies there is a morsel of flesh. إِذَا صَلَحَتْ صَلَحَ الْجَسَدُ كُلُّهُ وَإِذَا فَسَدَتْ فَسَدَ الْجَسَدُ كُلُّهُ أَلَا وَهِيَ الْقَلْبِ, that if it is rectified, the entire body will be rectified. And if it is spoilt and corrupt, the entire body will become spoilt and corrupt. This is the heart. So if we know that the greatest test in the Akhirah will be regarded with regards to the secrets that the heart carries, then this shows us that this is what we need to focus on in this world. And if we can rectify the heart, it will rectify our limbs. But there is a chance that our limbs can be rectified, but the secrets of our heart are hiding something else. And this is the munafiq. And that's why even when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he spoke about the khawarij, what did he say to the sahaba? He said, you would look at their salah and you would look at your salah. And their salah will be greater than your salah. Their fasting will be greater than your fasting. This is the sahaba he's speaking to, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Their acts of ibadah will be greater than your acts of ibadah. But what did he say? They'll recite the Quran and it will not go past their throats. It will not reach their hearts. So the Quran was only there to rectify their outer appearance, their outer ibadah. None of it reached their hearts. But if it had reached their hearts, then they would have been rectified completely. And that's why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam warned against them. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam commanded to kill them. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said they would leave Islam just like the arrow leaves the bow, because the iman did not reach their heart. So this tells us how important it is to focus on our hearts. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah At-Tariq, وَالسَّمَاءِ وَالطَّارِقِ, and by the sky and by At-Tariq. وَمَا أَدْرَاكَ مَا الطَّارِقِ, and what makes you know what At-Tariq is? النَّجْمُ الثَّاقِبِ, it is a piercing star. إِن كُلُّ نَفْسٍ لَمَّا عَلَيْهَا حَافِظٍ, that indeed for every person there is a guardian over it. فَلْيَنْظُرِ الْإِنسَانُ مِمَّ خُلِقٍ, so let man look at how he was created or what he was created from. خُلِقَ مِمَّا إِنْ دَافِقٍ, he was created from gushing liquids. يَخْرُجُ مِنْ بَيْنِ الصُّلْبِ وَالتَّرَائِبِ, it came out from between the ribs and the backbone. إِنَّهُ عَلَىٰ رَجْعِهِ لَقَادِرٍ, indeed he is able to bring them back. يَوْمَ تُبْلَى السَّرَائِرِ, the day when the secrets will be tested. Then he says subhanahu wa ta'ala, فَمَا لَهُ مِنْ قُوَّةٍ وَلَا نَاصِرٍ, that on that day which is the day of Qiyamah, when the secrets will be exposed, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, فَمَا لَهُ مِنْ قُوَّةٍ وَلَا نَاصِرٍ, that on that day this person will have no strength and he will have no one to help him. In this life you are either helped by someone around you or you have enough strength to help and protect yourself. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, on that day you will have no strength. You will not be able to protect yourself. وَلَا نَاصِرٍ, and you will have no one to give you victory. You will have no one to help you, no one to protect you. Because if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decrees punishment for you, then nothing can come between you and the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he says, فَمَا لَهُ مِنْ قُوَّةٍ وَلَا نَاصِرٍ. And that's why Allah jalla wa ala also, he says in the Quran, فَإِذَا نُفِخَ فِي الصُّورِ, that when it is blown into the trumpet, فَلَا أَنْسَابَ بَيْنَهُمْ يَوْمَئِذٍ وَلَا يَتَسَاءَلُونَ, that there will be no lineage between one another. That no one can come and say, this is my father, this is my son, this is my companion, this is my brother. There's no lineage between you on that day. No one is going to help you and protect you. So Yawm al-Qiyamah, everyone is for themselves. Even the Anbiya were for themselves. When the creation went to them, they said, myself, myself. And if this was the affairs of the Anbiya on that day, then the rest of the creation have more right to try and protect themselves, because they have less deeds than the Anbiya and they have more sins than the Anbiya. So Allah Jalla wa Ala said, فَمَا لَهُ مِنْ قُوَّةٍ وَلَا نَاصِرٍ, that they will have no strength on that day, so they cannot protect themselves. وَلَا نَاصِرٍ, and no one to help them and support them and defend them and protect them and give them victory. Then he says subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَالسَّمَاءِ ذَاتِ الرَّجْعِ وَالْأَرْضِ ذَاتِ الصَّدْعِ, he makes more oaths subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَالسَّمَاءِ, and by the sky, ذَاتِ الرَّجْعِ, the sky which has rain in it. وَالْأَرْضِ ذَاتِ الصَّدْعِ, and by the earth which parts and the earth which opens. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes an oath now by the sky that gives down rain, and by the earth which opens and allows the crops and the plants and the trees to grow out of it and the grains to grow out of it. Then he says subhanahu wa ta'ala, إِنَّهُ لَقَوْلٌ فَصَلٌ, he's speaking about the Qur'an, that indeed the Qur'an, it is لَقَوْلٌ فَصَلٌ, it is the true speech and the firm definite speech. This is the kitab of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When Allah jalla wa ala made the oath at the beginning of the surah, the ulama said that oath was a preparation and an introduction to this oath, which is an introduction and oath regarding the kitab of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at the beginning of the surah, when he made an oath by At-Tariq, and he said, النجم الثاقب, It is the piercing star. Allah Jalla wa Ala shows us at the beginning of this surah that He has protected the Quran by having angels that will throw the stars at the shayateen that try and come near the Quran. And then over here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is making an oath by the sky that gives down rain, that allows the earth to grow, to give us an indication that this is like the kitab of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If it enters your heart, it will spread around your limbs and you will begin to do good deeds. This growth will be the growth of good deeds and iman seen in your limbs that stem from your heart to your tongue and your limbs. So you will begin to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah Jalla wa Ala is telling us in this surah that He has protected the Qur'an. And not only has He protected the Qur'an, but if we were to implement the Qur'an, it will protect us. And it will allow iman to stem from our hearts to our bodies, to our limbs. So we will be able to worship Allah Jalla wa Ala thoroughly. So He says, وَالسَّمَاءِ ذَاتِ الرَّجْعِ. And by the sky, that which contains the rain. وَالْأَرْضِ ذَاتِ الصَّدْعِ. And by the earth which opens up, so the crops can grow out of it, the grains can grow out of it, the plants can come out of it. إِنَّهُ لَقَوْلٌ فَصْلٌ. That indeed, the Qur'an is لَقَوْلٌ فَصْلٌ. It is the firm speech, the speech which distinguishes between right and wrong, the criterion which distinguishes between right and wrong. And when the ulama speak about this verse in the Qur'an, they say this ayah in the Qur'an tells us that the Qur'an is the solution to all of our problems. The kitab of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the speech of Allah jalla wa ala, is the solution to all of our problems. إِنَّهُ لَقَوْلٌ فَصْلٌ. It is the firm speech, the speech which distinguishes between right and wrong, the speech which overcomes every other speech and is greater than every other speech from every aspect. So do we go back to the Qur'an for our affairs? When we have a problem, is the first thing we do is open the kitab of Allah Jalla wa Ala and the sunnah of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. We try and find a cure. We try and find a solution. We try and find a remedy. Or do we go elsewhere? This is one way to test our iman. To see, are we firm believers in the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or not? The Qur'an is the primary source for the believers, for all of their affairs. If we have problems in our marriage, we go back to the kitab of Allah Jalla wa Ala and the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If we have problems in our families, with our parents or our children or our siblings, we go back to the kitab of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If we have problems in our dealings, in our life, we go back to the kitab of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If we have problems with regards to wealth, with poverty, or children, we are unable to have children, or we have any problem that you can think of, if we go back to the kitab of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we will find something that will direct us to what we need, direct us to happiness in this life and the hereafter. The Quran is not just there to tell us how to work for our hereafter, but the Quran also tells us how to achieve what we need to achieve in this life. Allah jalla wa ala has mentioned in the Quran that He has made us the successors on this earth. He's not just going to say to us that He has made us the successors on this earth and then not tell us how to take over, not tell us how to control, and not tell us how to dominate, and not tell us how to gain victory. But Allah Jalla wa Ala has told us everything. And that's why Abu Dharr radiallahu anhu, he said, if the bird is flying, he pointed to the bird that was flapping its wings. He said, you can see the bird is flapping its wings. The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam has told us something about it. If it is beneficial for us, we would know something about it. He has told us everything, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that we need to know. مَا فَرَّتْنَا فِي الْكِتَابِ مِنْ شَيْءٍ. That we have not left anything out in the kitab. And the kitab directs us to the sunnah. So everything we need in our lives, we will find in the kitab and we find in the sunnah. One of the salaf, he was approached and he was asked, how do I increase in wealth? He said, make istighfar to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He said, how do I remove my sins? He said, make istighfar to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He said, how can I have property and gardens? He said, make istighfar to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He said, how can I have children? Increase in children. He said, make istighfar to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He said, how come every time I'm asking you something, you are telling me the same thing, make istighfar to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? He said, because this is the solution that is found in the Quran. وَقُلْتُ اسْتَغْفِرُوا رَبَّكُمْ إِنَّهُ كَانَ غَفَّارًا. That is, say, وَقُلْتُ اسْتَغْفِرُوا I said, make istighfar to your Lord. إِنَّهُ كَانَ غَفَّارًا Indeed, he is the one who forgives. So if you want your sins forgiven, what do you say? You say, أَسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهِ يُرْسِلِ السَّمَاءَ عَلَيْكُمْ مِدْرَارًا Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because you've said istighfar, he would allow the skies to rain upon you abundantly. What does this bring? This increases your wealth. It increases your crops. It allows increases the water nourishment that you need. يُرْسِلِ السَّمَاءَ عَلَيْكُمْ مِدْرَارًا وَيُمْدِدُكُمْ بِأَمْوَالٍ وَبَنِينَ And he subhanahu wa ta'ala will increase you in your wealth and increase you in your children. وَيَجْعَلْ لَكُمْ جَنَّاتٍ وَيَجْعَلْ لَكُمْ أَنْهَارًا And he will make for you gardens and he will make for you streams. The answer is in the Qur'an. If you want forgiveness from Allah Jalla wa ala, you make istighfar. If you want rain, you make istighfar. Meaning if you want provisions, you make istighfar. If you want wealth, you make istighfar. If you want children, you make istighfar. If you want land and property, you make istighfar. If you want the beauties of this world, you make istighfar. Everything is found in the kitab of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Maybe an ayah that we have all memorized, or an ayah that we have all recited. But how many of us are frequent with making istighfar to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? It will regulate our lives by making istighfar. We have no sins left on our bodies. Everything that we want in the dunya will come to us. Everything that is beneficial for us. Everything that we will be able to control and overcome our desires through. Allah Jalla wa'ala will give it to us in abundance because we made istighfar to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. إِنَّهُ لَقَوْلٌ فَصْلٌ This kitab is the clear speech from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is the thing that distinguishes between right and wrong. It is the answer and the solution to all of our problems. And if we have any problems, if we go back to the kitab of Allah Jalla wa'ala, we will find the solution to every problem that we have. Not just on an individual level, on a communal level, on a global level. The ummah will find all of the answers in the kitab of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why you find some of the ulama who are very strong in istinbat, in deriving things from the Qur'an. When it comes to all of these worldly affairs, whether it's the affairs of an entire country and nation, or whether it's the affairs of the entire ummah, or it's the affairs of individuals in societies, they will give you ayat in the Qur'an as if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed it specifically for that thing. As if Allah jalla wa ala revealed it for that. Because all of the answers are found in the kitab of Allah Jalla wa Ala. We just have to understand the book of Allah. Understand how to implement the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Everything will be found in there. And that's what we find even when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam passed away. This was the greatest calamity ever to hit mankind. There has never been a calamity like this. And there will never ever be a calamity like this. It was the passing away of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This was the end of revelation. Mankind will never ever see revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala again. This was the death of the greatest man to ever step foot on this earth. In fact, it was the death of the greatest of the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the greatest calamity that man had seen. And the Sahaba did not know how to take and how to bear this calamity. Because Allah jalla wa ala chose the greatest people to be with the greatest man, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this was his companion, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And when they saw this great calamity, they did not know how to deal with it. Umar radiallahu anhu, he had his sword in his hand, said, if anyone says that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has died, I will chop his head off. He was unable to take this calamity. So Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he was on a journey and he came back and he saw the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He had passed away, he was lying down on his bed, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He uncovered his face and he saw his beautiful face. He kissed him on his forehead, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he said, Tibta hayyan wa mayyitan ya Rasulallah. You were beautiful when you were alive, and even after you have passed away, O Messenger of Allah. Then Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he ascended the pulpit. He glorified Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and praised him. Then he said, Man kana ya'budu Muhammadan fa inna Muhammadan qad mat. Whoever worships Muhammad, then Muhammad has died. Wa man kana ya'budu Allah fa inna Allah hayyun la yamut. And whoever worships Allah, then Allah is alive and he will never die. Then he said, وَمَا مُحَمَّدٌ إِلَّا رَسُولٌ قَدْ خَلَتْ مِنْ قَبْلِهِ الرُّسُلُ أَفَإِمَّاتَ أَوْ قُتِلْ إِنْ قَلَبْتُمْ عَلَىٰ أَعْقَابِكُمْ Until the end of the ayah, that Muhammad is only a man. Many messengers have come before him. If he were to die or he was killed, would he then turn on your heels? Umar radiallahu anhu at that moment fell to the ground and began to weep. He said, it is as if I am hearing this verse for the first time in my life. The Qur'an was a solution to the greatest calamity that came on this earth. If the Qur'an can be a solution for the greatest calamity to come onto this earth, it can be a solution for every calamity that comes after it. Because no calamity was greater than that. And this shows you how great Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu was. Because he was able to bear the calamity more than Umar radiallahu anhu. But if we turn back to the Kitab of Allah Jalla wa'ala, we will find that we will think it will be as if the Qur'an was revealed for our life specifically. For us as individuals. For us at this time, living at this moment, it will be as if the Qur'an was revealed specifically to us. Because this is how miraculous the speech of Allah Jalla wa'ala is. Suitable for every person, suitable for every nation, suitable for every time. So if we hold on to this kitab, and we turn back to this kitab, we will find all of our problems will be answered by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. إِنَّهُ لَقَوْلٌ فَصْلٌ. Indeed, it is that speech, the firm speech, the speech that guides us. The speech that determines and distinguishes between right and wrong. The speech that if we hold on to, it will judge us and direct us to that which is pleasing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then Allah Jalla wa ala to emphasize on the importance of the Qur'an. To show you how all of this Qur'an is beneficial. And all of this Qur'an is important. He said subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَمَا هُوَ بِالْهَزْمِ. This Qur'an is not a joke. It is not a game. It is not speaking about things which are irrelevant. إِنَّهُ لَقَوْلٌ فَصْلٌ. It is a truthful speech which is firm. And it is not a speech which you can take lightly. To show us that do not turn your backs on the Qur'an. There is not a single letter in the Qur'an except that there is a benefit for having it there. There is not a single word or verse in the Qur'an except that the ummah can benefit from it. It is a miracle from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَمَا هُوَ بِالْهَزْمِ. It is not a joke. It is not amusement. It is not something that we play around with. It is not something that we throw behind our backs and belittle. It is something that we hold on to and we cling on to. And that's why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he told the Sahaba to cling on to the Kitab and the Sunnah with their molar teeth. Their molar teeth, why? So they have a firm grip on it. So they do not let it go, because this will be their guidance for eternity. وَمَا هُوَ بِالْهَزْرِ. And then Allah Jalla wa ala speaks about the disbelievers. إِنَّهُمْ يَكِيدُونَ كَيْدًا. That indeed they are plotting against you. They are plotting and they are planning against you, O Messenger of Allah. And they are plotting and planning against you, O companions of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And they are plotting and they are planning against you, O followers of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. إِنَّهُمْ يَكِيدُونَ كَيْدًا. They will always plot and they will always plan. This is what the shaitan has put within them. Because they are his helpers, they are his soldiers. So they will always try and take a Muslim out of his belief. They will always try and take a Muslim out of Iman. And they will always try their hardest to ensure that the Sharia of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not implemented on this earth. إِنَّهُمْ يَكِيدُونَ كَيْدًا. Indeed, they are plotting and they are planning. But then Allah Jalla wa ala to give comfort to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his followers, he says, وَأَكِيدُ كَيْدًا. And I am plotting and I am planning. They are plotting and they are planning. But Allah Jalla wa ala says, and I am plotting and I am planning. وَأَكِيدُ كَيْدًا. That can they come anywhere near the plans of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? They are plotting and planning because some of them are outwardly showing Islam. And they are hypocrites. And they are trying to dismantle Islam from its foundations. So they think that this is their plot and this is their plan. But what is the plan of Allah Jalla wa ala against them? When Allah Jalla wa ala lets them stand with the believers on Yawm al-Qiyamah, that they will all stand there. يَوْمَ يُكْشَفُ عَنْ سَاقٍ وَيُدْعَوْنَ إِلَى السُّجُودِ فَلَا يَسْتَطِيعُونَ. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will expose and uncover his shin. And they will be commanded to make sajda to Allah Jalla wa ala. And all of the believers will make sajda. And the hypocrites, it is like their back will turn into one bone. They will not be able to bow down to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They are planning, thinking that they can stand with the believers so they will be resurrected with them. So they can plot against them and dismantle them from their foundations. But the plan of Allah Jalla wa'ala is greater. And the plot of Allah Jalla wa'ala against their plot is greater. That they will stand thinking that they will be victorious because they will be with the believers. And then they will be exposed and humiliated in front of all of the believers. When Allah Jalla wa'ala commands them directly to bow down to Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. إِنَّهُمْ يَكِيدُونَ كَيْدًا وَأَكِيدُ كَيْدًا. Indeed they are plotting and they are planning. And I am plotting and I am planning. Says He subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then he says, فَمَهِّلِ الْكَافِرِينَ amhilhum ruwaida, that take it easy with the kafirin, give them some time. Do not be hasty against them, because you would see that the plan of Allah Jalla wa Ala will work against them. Sometimes Allah Jalla wa Ala, He lets them live for a long time. Innama numli lahum liyazdadu ithma. We give them long lives so that they can increase in sin, so they have more accountability and more punishment on Yawm al-Qiyamah. This is how Allah Jalla wa Ala plans against them. They think that Allah has given them all of these blessings, these houses, these palaces, these cars, every delight of the dunya they could have. They think that they have been given all of this. But what they do not know is this is a plan and a plot from Allah against their plots. So now when they stand on Yawm al-Qiyamah, they have to be accountable. They have to now show account for these houses and these palaces. Every penny that they have is haram, because Allah Jalla wa Ala has not made it lawful for them. Everything that Allah Jalla wa Ala has given them is haram for them to use, because they can only utilize it after they have become believers. Every good deed they perform is rejected, because the condition of a good deed is iman. So they will stand and say, but we gave charity, we helped our neighbors, we were generous and we were kind. But none of this will be on their scales, because all of this was rejected from them, because the condition of acceptance, which was iman, was not there. So every salah they missed as a disbeliever, they will be accountable for on Yawm al-Qiyamah. And every fast they missed as a disbeliever, they will be accountable for on Yawm al-Qiyamah. And every zakah they missed as a disbeliever, they will be accountable for it on Yawm al-Qiyamah. If they were to fast now, it will not be accepted from them, because they are not believers. If they were to pray, it will not be accepted, because they are not believers. If they were to give charity, it will not be accepted, because they are not believers. Allah says, مَا سَلَكَكُمْ فِي سَقَرْ. What caused you to enter the fire? What did they say? قَالُوا لَمْ نَكُمْ مِنَ الْمُصَلِّينَ. We are not from those who prayed. وَلَمْ نَكُنْ نُطْعِمُ الْمِسْكِينَ. And we did not feed the poor. وَكُنَّا نَخُوضُ مَعَ الْخَائِدِينَ. And we used to quarrel with those who quarrel. وَكُنَّا نُكَذِّبُ بِيَوْمِ الدِّينِ. And we used to disbelieve in the last day. So were they Muslims or were they disbelievers? They were disbelievers. Yet not praying salah made them go into the fire, and not giving zakah made them go into the fire. إِنَّهُمْ يَكِيدُونَ كَيْدًا وَأَكِيدُ كَيْدًا. This is how the plans and the plots of Allah Jalla wa Ala are against their planning and their plotting. All of this that Allah Jalla wa Ala has given them is a punishment for them. It's just increasing them in punishment. The more delights they get, the more punishment they will get. The more they will be held accountable for. So this is how strong the plan of Allah Jalla wa Ala is, and the plot of Allah Jalla wa Ala is against their plot. فَمَهِّلِ الْكَافِرِينَ أَمْهِلْهُمْ رُوَيْدًا. So take it easy with them. Do not be hasty in trying to go against them and destroying them. Do not be hasty in holding them to account, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has planned something for them. So if you are unable to overcome them in this world, do not worry, because Allah jalla wa ala has something ready for them. And that's why we find some of the greatest tyrants of this earth, from the past and the present, you find that some of them had lengthy lives, very long lives. Some of them had the dunya opening up to them, palaces and gardens and everything they can possibly think of. When it comes to wealth, you cannot count how much wealth they have. When it comes to possessions, you cannot count it. And sometimes the believer thinks, how can this person? He's had so many blessings in this life while he is doing this to the believers. This is because we haven't understood the plans and the plots of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But once we understand that Allah Jalla wa Ala plans and plots, and His planning and plotting is greater than their planning and plotting, and it will overcome their planning and plotting. وَمَكَرُوا وَمَكَرَ اللَّهُ وَاللَّهُ خَيْرُ الْمَاكِرِينَ. They plot and Allah plots, and Allah is the greatest of those who plot, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then we understand that let them have these delights in this world. Let them live lavishly. Let them have all of this, because when we see them being destroyed on Yawm al-Qiyamah, we will be the ones who are laughing at them when we see them going into eternal punishment. And for those who live like this, and those who were the tyrants, their punishment will be even more severe, because they had more blessings from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَمَهِّلِ الْكَافِرِينَ أَمْهِلْهُمْ رُوَيْدًا. So give them time. Let it be for a little while. Leave them for a little while. And you will see that the plots of Allah Jalla wa Ala and the plans of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will destroy them. So this is the surah that we find in the Quran. Allah Jalla wa Ala begins this surah by making an oath by the sky and the piercing star. And then He subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about how He guards creation, and He knows everything that they do. Then He tells us to reflect over ourselves and how we were created. And then He mentions His infinite ability to resurrect us. And when He resurrects us, subhanahu wa ta'ala, He told us about our secrets. Just like He's guarding us and He knows what we are doing, all of these secrets then will be exposed. Then they will come to its test. And after he mentioned this, he said, no one will have any strength on that day or anyone to help them. Then he makes an oath by the skies again and by the earth. And then he speaks about the Quran. How by holding on to this Quran, it will rectify all of our deeds. So those angels that are guiding us, if we are holding on to the Quran, they will witness only good from us. And if we use the Quran to direct us through all of our problems, then we will be successful on that day. Because this Quran is not a joke from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's not just amusement and play. It is everything that we need to be victorious in this world and in the hereafter. And then he told us about those who turn against the Quran and against the people of the Quran, that they'll be planning and plotting until Yawm al-Qiyamah. But do not worry about their planning and their plotting, because Allah Jalla wa'ala is also planning and He is also plotting subhanahu wa ta'ala. So give them time and you will find that Allah Jalla wa'ala will grasp them. And when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes them, He will not let go of them. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. Naam. Next one, inshallah.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. سبح اسم ربك الأعلى الذي خلق فسوى والذي قدر فهدى والذي أخرج المرعى فاجعله غثاء أحوى سنقرئك فلا تنسى إلا ما شاء الله إنه يعلم الجهر وما يخفى ونيسرك لليسرى فذكر إن نفعت الذكرى سيذكر من يخشى ويتجنبها الأشقى الذي يصلى النار الكبرى ثم لا يموت فيها ولا يحيا قد أفلح من تزكى وذكر اسم ربه فصلى بل تؤثرون الحياة الدنيا والآخرة خير وأبقى إن هذا لفي الصحف الأولى صحف إبراهيم وموسى.
Now we are going through Surah Al-A'la, the tafsir and the explanation of Surah Al-A'la. The scholars differed, is this Surah Makkiyah or Madaniyah? With the majority of them holding the view that this Surah is Makkiyah, that it was revealed before the Hijrah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to Al-Madinah. From the names of this Surah is Surah Al-A'la. But Allah Jalla wa Ala mentions this in the first verse, سَبِّحِ اسْمَ رَبِّكَ الْأَعْلَى. And also Surah Sabbih Hisma Rabbika Al-A'la. It is also called Surah Sabbih, because it is the only chapter in the Quran that begins with Sabbih. As other chapters in the Quran may begin with Sabbaha Lillahi. But this is with the command to make tasbih to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it is called Surah to Sabbih. We find that this Surah, Allah Jalla wa Ala, or the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he mentioned many ahadith about this surah, and we find this surah was a frequent surah recited by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam commanded Mu'adh radiyallahu an to make Salatul Isha light for the believers, one of the surahs he commanded him to recite in Salatul Isha was Surah Sabbih Isma Rabbikal A'la. So we find this was a guidance from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam given to Mu'adh to recite surahs of this length. سبح اسم ربك الأعلى أن والشمس وضحاها أن والليل إذا يغشى. We also find that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to frequently recite Surah سبح اسم ربك الأعلى and the following Surah, Surah الغاشية هل أتاك حديث الغاشية in صلاة الجمعة. And this is a hadith which is collected in the Sahih of Imam Muslim. So he used to frequently recite Surah الأعلى in the first rak'ah and Surah الغاشية in the second rak'ah. We also find that it was a common practice of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, if he was reciting witr as three rak'at, he would recite Surah Al-A'la in the first of the three rak'at, then Surah Al-Kafirun in the second rak'ah, and then Surah Al-Ikhlas in the third rak'ah. So a common practice of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to recite this surah in Salatul Witr. We also find that it was a common practice of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to recite Surah Al-A'la in Salat Al-Eid in the first rak'ah, and then Surah Al-Ghashiyah in the second rak'ah. So when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was in the gatherings of the believers, he would frequently recite Surah Al-A'la. We find it in Salat Al-Jum'ah, we find it in Salat Al-Eid, and we find the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam directed Mu'adh to reciting it in Salat Al-Isha, which is one of the three salawat which are performed out aloud. And also in Salat al-Witr, which a believer performs every night before he goes to sleep. So this is a surah that Allah Jalla wa Ala wanted us to keep repeating. And if He subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted us to keep repeating this surah, it shows us there is something very important in this surah for us to remind ourselves of. So what is the theme of this surah? What are the main topics Allah Jalla wa Ala discusses in this surah? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about the hereafter, and He compares it to the dunya, the world, the worldly life. And He speaks how the believers prefer the hereafter over this world, and how the disbelievers prefer this world over the hereafter. He subhanahu wa ta'ala also speaks about magnifying the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and glorifying and praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as this is the path of the believers that will save them from the azab of Jahannam. He also speaks about subhanahu wa ta'ala in this surah how to purify the heart, and He speaks about the importance of the heart. So when we find this surah, it speaks about the importance of the heart, and to accustom ourselves to making tasbih of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, glorifying and praising Him, and how to concentrate and focus on the hereafter, and how the message of focusing on the hereafter was the message that Allah Jalla wa Ala gave to all of the Anbiya. It shows us why we frequently repeat this surah again and again, so we can remind ourselves that this life is a temporary life, and the real life is the life of the hereafter. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala begins this surah by saying, سَبِّحْ اسْمَ رَبِّكَ الْأَعْلَى. سَبِّحْ اسْمَ رَبِّكَ الْأَعْلَى. There are 8 surahs in the Qur'an that Allah Jalla wa Ala begins with tasbih. 8 surahs in the Qur'an that Allah Jalla wa Ala begins with tasbih. How many surahs are there in the entire Qur'an? In the entire Qur'an? 114 surahs. This is something that we should all know. There are 114 surahs in the entire Qur'an. From these 114 surahs, the best of them and the greatest of them is? Surah Al-Fatiha. And the surah which is equivalent to a third of the Qur'an is? Surah Al-Ikhlas. And the first surah to be reviewed was? Surah Al-Alaq. Iqra' bismi rabbika alladhi khalaq. The first part of the surah. And from these chapters in the Qur'an, some of them are Makkiyah, and some of them are Madaniyah. As you mentioned, some were reviewed before Hijrah, and some were reviewed after Hijrah. And from these surahs are surahs that only speak about ahkam, rulings and verdicts. And some surahs only speak about the hereafter and the rights of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So from these surahs, 8 of these surahs, they begin with tasbih, praising and glorifying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Surah Al-Isra begins with tasbih. Surah Al-Nahl begins with tasbih. Surah Al-Hadid begins with tasbih. Surah Al-Hashr begins with tasbih. Surah Al-Saff begins with tasbih. Surah Al-Jumu'ah begins with tasbih. And Surah Al-Taghabun begins with tasbih. And Surah Al-A'la begins with tasbih. But this is the only surah where Allah Jalla wa Ala commands us to make tasbih at the beginning of the surah. So He will say, سَبَّحَ لِلَّهِ. That Allah Jalla wa Ala is praised. Or Subhana Alladhi, or praise be to the one. But here He is saying, سَبِّحْ اسْمَ رَبِّكَ الْأَعْلَى. Praise be to the name of your Lord, Al-A'la, the highest. So this is the only surah that Allah Jalla wa Ala begins by commanding us to praise Him, Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. So this tasbih that Allah Jalla wa Ala is commanding us, exalt the name of your Lord, praise the name of your Lord. When He says the name of your Lord, it means that we have to say it with our tongues. Because if it was just to praise and glorify Allah Jalla wa Ala, we can praise and glorify Him with sujood. And we can praise and glorify him with dua. And we can praise and glorify him by other means. By even giving charity, we are praising and glorifying Allah Jalla wa'ala through this. But when he says, سَبِّحْ اسْمَ رَبِّكَ الْأَعْلَى, it means praise and glorify Allah Jalla wa'ala with your tongue. Because you are going to now praise the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Most High. When this was revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, اِجْعَلُوهَا فِي سُجُودِكُمْ, that make this in your sajda. سَبِّحْ اسْمَ رَبِّكَ الْأَعْلَى, praise the name of your Lord, the highest. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, make it in your sajda. So what do we say in our sajda? What do we say? سُبْحَانَ رَبِّي الْأَعْلَى. We are praising Allah the Most High. We are praising Him in our sajda with this. And when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed, فَسَبِّحْ بِاسْمِ رَبِّكَ الْعَظِيمِ, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, اِجْعَلُوهَا فِي رُكُوعِكُمْ, that make this in your ruku'. So in our ruku' we say, سُبْحَانَ رَبِّي الْعَظِيمِ. So we say, سُبْحَانَ رَبِّي الْعَظِيمِ when we are in ruku'. And we say, سُبْحَانَ رَبِّي الْأَعْلَى when we are in sujood. And this is from this verse, سَبِّحْ اسْمَ رَبِّكَ الْأَعْلَى. This tasbih that Allah Jalla wa'ala has commanded us to say, Subhanallah, or Subhana Rabbi al-A'la, or any type of tasbih that we make to Allah Jalla wa'ala, what does it mean? When we make tasbih to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we are saying that Allah Jalla wa'ala is perfect and He is free from all deficiencies. This is the meaning of tasbih. So we say Subhanallah, we are saying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is perfect and He is free of all defects and deficiencies. It is like His name As-Salam and like His name Al-Quddus, that we are freeing Allah Jalla wa'ala from all imperfection that people attribute to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When they attribute to Allah Jalla wa'ala a son, we are saying Subhanallah, that Allah Jalla wa'ala is free from this. When they attribute to Allah any type of imperfection, we are saying Subhanallah, that Allah Jalla wa'ala is free from this. And that's why this is from the most beloved speech to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, أَحَبُّ الْكَلَامِ إِلَى اللَّهِ أَرْبَعًا, that the most beloved speech to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is four. Subhanallah, walhamdulillah, wa la ilaha illallah, wa Allahu akbar. This is the most beloved speech to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the hadith is in Sahih Muslim. So the most beloved speech to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is four. Subhanallah, walhamdulillah, wa la ilaha illallah, wa Allahu akbar. And this is all dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Sabbih isma rabbika al-a'la. Praise and glorify the name of your Lord the highest. Someone may ask us now, isn't the Qur'an the most beloved speech to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? So why did the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say the most beloved speech to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is for? Does anyone have an answer to this? No.
The Qur'an is the speech of Allah, so that's the most beloved from the speech of Allah, but from the speech of
Excellent. So the most beloved speech to Allah jalla wa ala is the Qur'an. Because this is his speech subhanahu wa ta'ala. But the most beloved speech of man to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Subhanallah, Alhamdulillah, wa la ilaha illallah, Allahu Akbar. So this is the most beloved speech of man to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is how we reconcile between the hadith. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam also said regarding the tasbih, من قال سبحانallah wa bihamdi في يوم مئة مرة, whoever says Subhanallah wa bihamdi 100 times in a day, حطت خطاياه وإن كانت مثل زبد البحر, all of his sins will be forgiven, even if they are equivalent to the foam on the sea. So this is from the virtue of saying tasbih to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to saying subhanallah. We also find that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said to the sahaba, أَيَعْجِزُ أَحَدُكُمْ أَنْ يَكْسِبَ كُلَّ يَوْمٍ أَلْفَ حَسَنَةٍ, do any of you find it difficult to achieve and to attain 1,000 good deeds in a day? So the sahaba, they asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, how do we do this? Imagine now the Prophet ﷺ saying to us, is it difficult for you to achieve 1,000 good deeds a day? So the Sahaba said, O Messenger of Allah, how do we do this? So the Prophet ﷺ said, يُسَبِّحْ مِئَةَ تَسْبِيحَ, to say Subhanallah 100 times. فَيُكْتَبُ لَهُ أَلْفُ حَسَنَةً, so then 1,000 good deeds will be written for him. أَوْ يُحَطُّ عَنْهُ أَلْفُ خَطِيئَةً, or 1,000 sins will be removed from him. And the hadith is in the Sahih of Imam Muslim. So just to sit down and say Subhanallah, Subhanallah, Subhanallah 100 times, it gives us 1,000 rewards, or it removes 1,000 sins. 1,000 rewards, or it removes 1,000 sins. And it will only take us a minute or two to say this. And this shows you how great this surah is, that commands us, that begins by commanding us to make tasbih to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is from the characteristics of the believers, that we frequently remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We make tasbih of Allah, we make tahmeed of Allah, we make takbir of Allah, we make tahleel of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We say subhanallah, we say alhamdulillah, we say Allahu Akbar, we say la ilaha illallah. And that's like the Prophet said, kalimatan habibatani ila rahman. And you know the hadith, the two phrases which are very beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which are very light on the tongues and which are very heavy on the scales. Subhanallah wa bihamdihi subhanallah al-azim. Again, doing tasbih of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We find that Allah jalla wa ala commands us in His Quran to frequently remember Him. وَالذَّاكِرِينَ اللَّهَ كَثِيرًا وَالذَّاكِرَاتِ. The men and women that remember Allah frequently. اذكروا اللَّهَ ذِكْرًا كَثِيرًا وَسَبِّحُوهُ بُكْرَةً وَأَصِيلًا. They remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala frequently and make tasbih in the mornings and in the afternoons to say how virtuous making tasbih to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is. How many of us actually sit down and make tasbih 1,000 times or 10,000 times, like Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu? Before he used to go to sleep, he used to say tasbih thousands of times before he used to go to sleep every night, because he knows the virtue of tasbih. How many of us actually make tasbih to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at all in the day? And this is something that Allah jalla wa ala is commanding us in a surah that we should be listening to almost every Friday and almost every Eid and reciting almost every witr and maybe hearing frequently in Salatul Isha. This is a surah that Allah jalla wa ala is telling us, sabbih isma rabbika al-a'la, that praised the name of your Lord, Al-A'la, the highest. Do we know what happens to us when we actually make dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Not just tasbih, but every type of dhikr. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has appointed angels for different things. So there are some angels that are on either side of us, right, recording the good deeds and recording the bad deeds. There are other angels that will come to us in our graves and they will ask us questions. Who is your Lord? What is your religion? And who was the man that was sent to you? There is an angel that brought the revelation down to the prophets and gives the message to the rest of the angels. There is an angel who directs the clouds and the rain to certain lands that Allah Jalla wa'ala wants the rain to touch these lands. There is an angel that will blow on the horn or the trumpet that will take the life of all of the creation by it and then resurrect them again once he blows in it again. There is an angel that will guard the doors of Jannah and an angel that will guard the doors of Jahannam. There are angels that will stand in rows that are quick to come to fulfill the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And from these angels that Allah jalla wa ala have, there are angels who are just traversing the earth. This is their job. This is the role that Allah jalla wa ala has given them. They are just traversing the earth looking for people who are making tasbih and tahmeed and takbir and tahleel. Looking for people who are remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is their only role. And then they report it back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in the hadith of Abi Hurairah, which is in the Sahihain, he said, "Inna lillahi malaika," that Allah jalla wa ala has angels, "yatufuna fi al-turuq, yaltamisuna ahla al-zikr." What they do is they just traverse the earth and they look for the people who are remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the only role. "Fa'idha wajadu qawman yadhkuruna Allah," if they find any group of people that are remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that are mentioning Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, "tanadaw halummu ila hajatikum, halummu ila hajatikum," they begin to shout and call. These are the people you are looking for. These are the people you are looking for. So imagine these angels now, they are scattered on this earth. They are looking for those people who are remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And as soon as one of them finds them, he begins to call. So the other angels, they gather around. Now, what are we doing now in this gathering? Are we remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Yes. Sitting down and learning about the deen of Allah Jalla wa Ala and the kitab of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is learning about the religion of Allah Jalla wa Ala, is doing dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So imagine now an angel has just come to this gathering and he has witnessed this, that we are doing dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So now he shouts to the rest of the angels. He says, "Halummu ila hajatikum, halummu ila hajatikum," that come on, this is the people that you are looking for. This is the need that you have been sent for. This is your role now being fulfilled over here. So come over here, come over here. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "فَيَحُفُّونَهُمْ بِأَجْنِحَتِهِمْ إِلَى السَّمَاءِ الدُّنْيَا." All of these angels now, they put out their wings and they encircle them with their wings until they reach the skies of the world. Sama' al-dunya. Sama' al-dunya is not the sky that we see above us. Sama' al-dunya is the sama' of the dunya, which is the sky after this. And under this sky is the sun and the moon and the stars and the planets and the galaxy and all of this. So this is not the sky of the dunya that we see. The dunya is greater than this. So Allah Jalla wa'ala, the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam mentions that they put out their wings and they encircle the gathering until they reach the sky of the world. فَيَسْأَلُهُمْ رَبُّهُمْ وَهُوَ أَعْلَمُ مِنْهُمْ مَا يَقُولُ عِبَادِي. And then their Lord asked them, even though he already knows them, what they're going to say. He knows more than them. And he's saying, what are my slaves saying? What are they saying? Why did Allah Jalla wa'ala ask if he already knows them? Because he wants us to hear this conversation between them and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He wants us to hear this conversation, so now we work harder to do the dhikr of Allah Jalla wa'ala, so we can imagine this happening again and again and again. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to the angels, what are my slaves? What are they saying? So the angels, they say to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, يسبحونك ويكبرونك ويحمدونك ويمجدونك. They're saying subhanallah. They're saying alhamdulillah. They're saying Allahu Akbar. And they are magnifying you. So Allah Jalla wa'ala then says to the angels, وَهَلْ رَأَوْنِي. Have they ever seen me before? So the angels, they say, لا والله ما رأوك. No, by Allah, they have never seen you. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَكَيْفَ لَوْ أَنَّهُمْ رَأَوْنِي. How would they be if they had seen me? If they are worshipping Allah Jalla wa'ala like this, and they haven't seen Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, how would they be if they had seen Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? So the angels, they say, لَوْ أَنَّهُمْ رَأَوْكَ. If they had seen you, they would do more tasbih. And they would do more ibadah. And they would glorify you and praise you and venerate you even more. This is how they would be. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala now asked the angels, فَمَا يَسْأَلُونِي. What are they asking me for? Now they are doing all of this. What are they asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for? The angels reply to Allah Jalla wa'ala. And they say, يَسْأَلُونَكَ الْجَنَّةِ. They are asking you for Jannah. This is what they want from you, Allah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to the angels, وَهَلْ رَأَوْهَا. Had they seen Jannah? The angels will say, لَا وَاللَّهِ مَا رَأَوْهَا. No, by Allah, they have not seen Jannah. So Allah Jalla wa'ala will say, وَكَيْفَ لَوْ أَنَّهُمْ رَأَوْهَا. How would they be if they had seen Jannah? So the angels say, لَوْ أَنَّهُمْ رَأَوْهَا كَانُوا أَشَدَّ عَلَيْهَا حِرْصًا. If they had seen Jannah, they would desire Jannah more. They would want it more. They would do everything they could possibly do to get to Jannah. So then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, what are they seeking refuge in me from? What are they asking protection from? So the angels, they say, يَتَعَوَّذُونَ مِنَ النَّارِ. They are seeking a protection from the fire of Jahannam. Then Allah Jalla wa'ala says to them, وَهَلْ رَأَوْهَا. Had they seen this fire of Jahannam? Here the angels say, لَا وَاللَّهِ يَا رَبِّي مَا رَأَوْهَا. No, by Allah, our Lord, they have never seen Jahannam. So Allah Jalla wa'ala asked them, وَكَيْفَ لَوْ أَنَّهُمْ رَأَوْهَا. How would they be now if they had seen Jahannam? Now the angels say, لَوْ أَنَّهُمْ رَأَوْهَا. If they had seen Jahannam, they would fear Jahannam more than anything. And they would flee from it more than anything. All of this is, this conversation is regarding who? Inshallah ta'ala, it's regarding us. It's regarding those who are remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah Jalla wa'ala says to the angels, فَأُشْهِدُكُمْ أَنِّي قَدْ غَفَرْتُ لَهُمْ. I hold all of you angels to witness that I have just forgiven all of them. This is how merciful Allah Jalla wa'ala is, especially to those who remember Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then one of the angels, he says, فَيَقُولُ مَلَكٌ مِنَ الْمَلَائِكَةِ فِيهِمْ فُلَانٌ لَيْسَ مِنْهُمْ إِنَّمَا جَاءَ لِحَاجَةٍ. In their gathering there was a man, he wasn't from them. He just came for a need. Imagine now we're sitting here in the masjid. Somebody now, he's left his coat here, he comes in the masjid and he takes his coat and then he goes out again. So an angel, he says, there was a man, he wasn't from their gathering. He just came for a need that he had. Because Allah Jalla wa'ala just said he just forgave the whole gathering. So he ended up being part of that gathering and then he left. So what's the situation of that man? Like someone is coming to the masjid now. What is the situation of this person? So Allah Jalla wa'ala says, هُمُ الْجُلَسَاءَ لَا يَشْقَى بِهِمْ جَلِسُهُمْ. They are a gathering that anyone that comes with them, they will not be left in despair. Meaning the mercy of Allah Jalla wa'ala is so great, it even encompasses the person who wasn't from their gathering. Just because he was with them, the barakah of their gathering went on to this person as well. So if this is going to be how Allah Jalla wa'ala treats the person who was a companion of the Salihin, who just happened to be in the gathering of the Salihin, imagine how merciful he will be to the Salihin subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he says subhanahu wa ta'ala, فَاذْكُرُونِي أَذْكُرْكُمْ. وَاشْكُرُوا لِي وَلَا تَكْفُرُونَ. Remember me and I will remember you. If we are remembered by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we have nothing to be worried about. If Allah jalla wa ala remembers us, we have nothing to be worried about. He says subhanahu wa ta'ala in a hadith Qudsi, أَنَا عِنْدَ ظَنِّ عَبْدِي بِي وَأَنَا مَعَهُ إِذَا ذَكَرَنِي. I am just as my slave he wants me to be, just as my slave thinks of me, and I am with him when he remembers me. If we want Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be with us, we will remember him. This tasbih of Allah jalla wa ala, and tahmeed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and takbir of Allah jalla wa ala, is something that a believer needs to accustom himself to. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke about the hypocrites, he spoke about how little they would remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He says jalla wa ala, إِنَّ الْمُنَافِقِينَ يُخَادِعُونَ اللَّهَ وَهُوَ خَادِعُهُمْ. The munafiqeen, they try to deceive Allah, but Allah is the one who deceives them. وَإِذَا قَامُوا إِلَى الصَّلَاةِ قَامُوا كُسَالَى. If they stand for the salah, they stand with laziness. يُرَاءُونَ النَّاسِ, they just want to show the people. وَلَا يَذْكُرُونَ اللَّهَ إِلَّا قَلِيلًا. They do not remember Allah except for a little. This is the munafiqeen. They only remember Allah جل وعلا a little bit. When the sahabi asked the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, tell me something, that if I were to do it, it will encompass the entire Sharia of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That there are too many things for us to do in the Sharia from the voluntary actions. I want something that if you were to direct me towards it, it will be as if I have done everything. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, لا يزال لسانك رطبا من ذكر الله عز وجل. As long as your tongue is moist with the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you keep saying subhanallah and you keep saying alhamdulillah, it will be as if you have done all of the sharia of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because this will prevent you from every sin, and it will only direct you to that which is pleasing for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Remember, our hearts are between the two fingers of the fingers of Ar-Rahman. And Allah jalla wa ala decrees what will happen to us. Sometimes we find it extremely hard to do ibadah. And sometimes we find it extremely easy to do ibadah. We find that maybe in Ramadan we are able to recite the Quran with ease. But outside Ramadan, it becomes difficult for us to recite the Quran. Maybe we find there are times we can stand up for Qiyamul Layl and we just feel like standing and praying to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And at other times, it becomes very difficult for us to stand. And we can't even stand for one rak'ah. Maybe at times we find it very easy to attend a masjid for jama'ah. And at other times, we find it extremely difficult. Maybe at times we find it very easy to fast. And at other times, we find it very difficult to fast. If we do dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala frequently, Allah would make all of this easy for us. In Ramadan we are fasting. In Ramadan we are reciting Quran. How easy is it for us to stand at night for Qiyamul Layl? How easy is it for us to stay away from sins? Because we are continuously doing ibadah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The more ibadah we do, the more we will be able to worship Allah jalla wa ala, and the easy it will become for us. How was the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam able to stand up for hours and hours in salah? How were the sahaba able to fast for days and months? It was said about some of the sahaba, like Aisha radiallahu anha, كانت تصوم الدهر, that she used to fast the entire year except for the few days which were prohibited. Like Abu Darda radiallahu anhu, كان يصوم الدهر, he used to fast the entire year except for the few days that were prohibited. How were they able to fast like this? How were they able to stand for hours on end reciting the Quran and praying to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? When they would walk past the house of Abu Bakr, they would just hear him recite Quran. This was the adah, the practice of Abu Bakr, that you could hear him. Sometimes he would sit on the roof of his house, just reciting the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is how they found enjoyment, worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is how they would pass their time, worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because the more they worshipped him, the more Allah jalla wa ala directed their hearts to ibadah. And directed their hearts to find ibadah easy. We may stand for two raka'ah, we can see someone standing for the entire night. It was said about Uthman radiallahu anhu, and it is reported with an authentic chain, that he was at the Kaaba, he was behind the maqam, at the Kaaba. He stood for one raka'ah witr, and he stood for the entire night, and he recited the whole Qur'an in one raka'ah. Uthman radiallahu anhu. It's reported with an authentic chain on Uthman radiallahu anhu. How was he able to do this? If we try and do this, we will not be able to do this. Maybe after half a juz, maybe less, maybe one juz, maybe five juz, maybe 10 juz. Maybe we will not be able to do anything at all. But we find we do not have that same level of commitment. Why is this? Because maybe our level of ibadah is not good enough to make ibadah easy for us. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to make something easy for us, He will make it easy. So when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, continuously moving our tongue in the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is as if it encompasses the entire Sharia. Why? It's because it makes all of the acts of ibadah easy for us. These hearts of ours that are between the two fingers of Ar-Rahman, Allah Jalla wa Ala will change them and direct them towards ibadah and facilitate it for us and make it easy for us, so we will not find any hardship in this ibadah. Just like in times when we are strong in iman, we find it easy to perform ibadah. This can become our regular practice in our daily lives if we accustom ourselves to remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, worshipping Allah Jalla wa Ala, glorifying and praising and magnifying Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is the message, the first message of this surah. Allah Jalla wa Ala begins by saying, سَبِّحْ اسْمَ رَبِّكَ الْأَعْلَى, that exalt the name of your Lord, the Most High. سَبِّحْ اسْمَ رَبِّكَ. So we say, Subhanallah, Subhanallah, Subhanallah. Or when we are in sajda now, we know why we are saying it. We say, Subhana Rabbi al-A'la. And Allah Jalla wa Ala used His name here, Al-A'la. Why did He use His name, Al-A'la? Because Al-A'la shows us that He is free from any deficiency. Al-A'la means the highest. The highest in His self, that He is above the entire creation. And the highest in His attributes, His sifat, that His attributes are greater than any of the attributes of the creation. All of His attributes are attributes of perfection. And He is the highest, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we say, Subhana Rabbi al-A'la. And that's why when we are in sajda, we say, Subhana Rabbi al-A'la. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, the closest we come to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is when we are in sajda. Why are we closest to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when we are in sajda? Because the most honorable part of our bodies is our face. This is the most honorable part of our bodies. And when we have lowered our face to the ground, we will only do this for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and no one else. So when we lower our face to our ground, we have put the most honorable part of our bodies in the lowest possible place it could go. So then when we do this, we remember that Allah jalla wa ala can never become low. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is always the highest. So we say, Subhana Rabbi al-A'la, when we go into sajda. Glorifying Allah, freeing Allah jalla wa ala from any imperfection or any deficiencies that people attribute to Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we are so close to Allah in sajda because we cannot become in a more humble state than we are when we are in sajda. Because this is the lowest we can put the most honorable part of our bodies. So we say, Subhana Rabbi al-A'la. When the Prophet ﷺ used to ascend a mountain, what did he say? Anyone know? He used to say, Allahu Akbar. Glorify Allah. Because when you are ascending, you think that you are great now because you are high. So then you say, Allahu Akbar, to remind yourself that Allah is the greatest. When he used to descend from the mountains, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he used to say, Subhanallah. Why did he say, Subhanallah? Because now we are going to a low place. And we are freeing this from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because Allah jalla wa ala is the highest. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to say, Subhanallah. When he used to remove any imperfection for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he used to say, Allahu Akbar. When he used to glorify and praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and magnify Him. So this surah, it begins with, سَبِّحْ اسْمَ رَبِّكَ الْأَعْلَى. Praise be the name of your Lord, the Most High. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says He is Al-A'la, it means He is above the creation subhanahu wa ta'ala. And there is nothing above Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is above the creation, and the roof of the creation is the arsh of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And He subhanahu wa ta'ala is above the throne. And there are so many ayat in the Quran where Allah jalla wa ala says He is above. He says subhanahu wa ta'ala, أَأَمِنْتُمْ مَنْ فِي السَّمَاءِ. Do you feel secure of the one who is in the sama? And the sama, as we mentioned, it means that which is high. So he's in the highest place, subhanahu wa ta'ala. When Allah jalla wa ala ascended Isa alayhi salam to himself, he said what? Bar rafa'ahu Allahu ilayh. He raised him to himself. When Allah jalla wa ala spoke about our deeds, he said, ilayhi yas'adu al-kalimu al-tayyib wal-amalu al-salih yarfa'u. To him ascend the good words, and the good deeds go up to him, subhanahu wa ta'ala, showing that he is above. When he spoke about the malaika, he says, يَخَافُونَ رَبَّهُمْ مِنْ فَوْقِهِمْ. They fear their Lord who is above them, showing that He is above, subhanahu wa ta'ala. He says, سَبِّحْ اسْمَ رَبِّكَ الْأَعْلَى, to show that He is above, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this shows you, this is the aqeedah also of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, and the aqeedah of the believers, that Allah Jalla wa Ala is above the creation, and He is separate and distinct from His creation. Nothing from the creation is part of Him subhanahu wa ta'ala, and He is not part of His creation subhanahu wa ta'ala. Rather, He is above the creation, and He is separate and distinct from the creation subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he says, سَبِّحْ اسْمَ رَبِّكَ الْأَعْلَى. Praise be the name of your Lord, Al-A'la. And we've come now to Salat Al-Isha. So we'll stop here today insha'Allah ta'ala, and we'll continue with Surah Al-A'la next week in the following dars. We ask Allah Jalla wa Ala to grant us beneficial knowledge and to make this knowledge a proof for us and not against us. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us understanding of the Qur'an and allow us to live through the Qur'an and be the living examples of the Qur'an. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us khushu and concentration in our salat. So when we understand the Qur'an, we can understand and focus in our salat. And we can concentrate and understand and enjoy the Qur'an in our salat. We ask Allah Jalla wa Ala to make our salat like the salat of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his companions. Wa sallallahu wa sallam ala nabina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.